Please give another hand to the San Antonio Youth Ballet from the San Antonio Ballet School.
Isn't that wonderful?
Good afternoon, and welcome to the presidential address for the 2017 annual meeting of AERA. We're delighted to have you join us to celebrate and to hear AERA President Dr. Vivian Lynette Gadsden, the William T. Carter Professor of Child Development and Professor of Education at the University of Pennsylvania.
Let us tell you a little about Vivian, although she really needs no introduction. Broadly speaking, Vivian's research takes a life course developmental perspective that integrates historical and contemporary social analysis. Across her work, she seeks to uncover the cultural repertoires, strengths, as well as the needs that young children, youth, and families bring to learning, schooling, health, and well-being. Guided by interests in the cultural and familial domains in which children, youth, and adults form identities, Vivian's scholarship examines how these identities are leveraged while also documenting the social hierarchies that constrain and enable opportunity. As part of this scholarship, Vivian is concerned with the ways language and literacy practices contribute to the development, engagement, and well-being of vulnerable populations.
We can perhaps trace some roots of her work to two early experiences. When Vivian was 5 years old, she received a typewriter as a gift. She did not just write her own stories. She dedicated herself to assisting her father in his work in the Episcopal Church, addressing envelopes for letters that he would send. Completely unaware of the consequences of such involvement, she was becoming literate in different genres, and the seeds which we today bear testimony had been planted. Such engagement was mediating her literacies and her interest in literacy development.
Connections and relationships were also at the basis of her early experiences within her community. For example, when Vivian was growing up at the corner store, she was rewarded with extra cookies for good grades, as the store owner would follow her school achievements with such rewards. The importance of community involvement and affirmation left its mark.
With expertise in child development, developmental psychology, family cultural studies, and education, her research examines how students learn, as well as the cultural and social contexts that facilitate their learning. By examining family and community life systems, she focuses on the capacities of practitioners and systems to respond to the needs of children and families. Notably, she has developed a robust framework that can be used to examine beliefs about learning and literacy, approaches to teaching diverse populations, and the construction of students' and families' identities, and their perceptions about the value of education and equal access to quality schooling. Oriented towards social change and committed to improving the human condition, Vivian asks questions about race, class, gender, sexual diversity, and differences across her empirical work. Her transdisciplinary perspective and mixed method studies focus on learners most at risk for academic, economic, and health vulnerabilities across social and educational institutions.
Vivian has contributed to national conversations working in the Clinton White House Initiative on Fathers and Families, to working with foundations on related topics of young children and their parents. Vivian has been an extraordinary leader at the University of Pennsylvania. She has served as the director of the National Center on Fathers and Families since its establishment, and was associate director of the National Center on Adult Literacy, among many other contributions.
Indeed, Vivian is a leader in our profession. In addition to being the current president of AERA, she has served as vice president for AERA's Division G and was co-editor-in-chief of the Education Researcher. She's held numerous leadership roles also in the Society for Research and Child Development, including serving as program chair, as well as a number of other committees. She's a fellow of AERA and was a resident scholar at the Spencer Foundation, and she's a member of the National Academy of Education.
In awe and with humility, we try to follow. And now we share the honor and pleasure to bring Vivian to you. Dr. Vivian Lynette Gadsden, President of the American Educational Research Association 2017, the audience is yours.
Get the text.
Many thanks, so many thanks to Angela and James. I could not have done it without you. And although I really can't see you, I know you look great. As I said earlier, James, whom I've known my entire career as an incredible friend and scholar, and Angela, whose intellect and general goodwill are unquestionable, have been exceptional in their contributions to building this annual program and managing, let us say, my overzealousness at times. I want to say thank you to the lovely Antonella, daughter of Angela and Alfredo. You heard Alfredo mention her earlier. And I want to apologize for any time I had to take her mom away from her. I want to also applaud those girls who are in the San Antonio Youth Ballet. They were terrific, and their director is Danielle Campbell. The people of San Antonio have been so generous, in particular, the people who have helped us here in the convention center, the people who've served us, the people who have set this up for today. My many, many thanks. And thanks to all of you for joining me here today for this presidential address. I am appreciative for your commitment to AERA and the field as we launch into our second century. I also ask you to acknowledge and join me in honoring the sacred ground on which we meet, where indigenous people who claim Central Texas as their ancestral territory. So I must share my appreciation to many others as well, not all of whom I will name, but a few of whose names appear on the screen, certainly not all. From my own institution, the University of Pennsylvania, my outstanding dean, Pamela Grossman, as well as former deans Lazarson, Furman, and Porter. My extraordinary colleagues, especially those from my teaching division, Gerald Campano, Amy Storniola, Ebony Thomas, Diane Woff, and Susan Lytle, you may be retired, but you're still with us, and honorary divisional member, Torch Lytle. And I want to acknowledge the incredible staff throughout the school who have been my inspiration. And two of those people are here today. They have known me probably throughout my entire time at Penn. And that's Lorraine Hightower and Penny Creedon. Where are you? Okay. They are the maintainers of the sanity. Then there are my students, current and past. Those assigned to me and those who just show up, take a seat, and start talking, usually when I'm my busiest. You are too many and too precious, and I'm very proud of you. I hope you will stay true to your commitment to rigorous inquiry, the ideals of social justice, and making a difference in all that you do. Perhaps my deepest appreciation in getting the work done for the past several years since holding my first office in AERA goes to Felice Levine. We've had such a ride this past year and over the years, and I want to congratulate you on your year as president of the World Educational Research Association. Let's give Felice a hand here. You are a terrific scholar, and your commitment and sheer brilliance have advanced AERA in countless ways, and the AERA staff, especially Robert Smith, who makes our public events seem effortless. Jerry Shrove, I call him the memory. Lori, Diane, Rue, Sylvie, Megan, Samara, Tony, Sarita, Morgan, Kayla, Victoria, Bidyu, David, Norm, Christy, Nathan, Andrew, and Daryl, and the many others whose names are on the screen, navigating the multiple events, the policy announcements, responding to members, responding to others in the field. The list goes on. Most important to my strength of purpose, my understanding of what it means to make a difference, and to embracing the challenges that I would face have been my biological family, whose own willingness to sacrifice to reduce discrimination, create opportunities for others, and work for justice without recognition or self-adulation have been at the core of my work inside and outside the academy. My husband, Lindsay Keith, is an example of what a husband and father should and can be. And then our two children are here. Two of our four children are here, Baron and Marshall. Hope you will always continue to want to improve yourselves. Our two other children, Miles and Ruby, are in the throes of final examinations, and I can only pray that they are studying. I want to also thank counsel and the executive board. These are highly committed members of our society. And last but not least, I want to thank three of my current students. Min Derry did that movie that you just saw on the screen. And she has worried this entire meeting about this talk. And then there is Ora Budaki, who was very instrumental in helping with the PowerPoint. And last but not least, Windry Foxworth Johnson, who just does it all. We've had good fortune this year in fulfilling new goals for content and programming, three of which are long-awaited ideas about Felice, about which Felice and I and others talked over many years, in some cases up to 15 years. The Centennial Lecture Series, which was outstanding in those six cities, the Americas Initiative, linking North, South America and the Caribbean, that was launched in July of 2016, and many of its members are here today, and I want to welcome you and say how delighted I am that you are here. And then third, the AERA, Society for Research in Child Development Early Career Fellowship Program. And there are 22 scholars in that program who are also here. Not unlike other former presidents, I vacillated among multiple options for this talk. Should I simply focus on a single issue or on new ideas and their potential, on the broad base of factors that affect our field, or a little of all? How much of me should I include? I've noticed that past presidents have differed in the degree to which they situate this address within their own cultural and social histories and experiences. For most of my life, I have been a very private person. But I have reflected on the uni-focused and unidimensional nature of research, designs, and reporting. With researchers, myself included, sifting through the lived experiences of others while our lives are private. I asked whether and how to offer the cultural and social context that brought me to this place and shaped my interaction with different bodies of knowledge and any ability I may have to embrace the daily affordances and difficulties and the precepts that inform my inquiry. So here goes. I was born in a town not far from Charleston, South Carolina, and I am the youngest of five children in a family fiercely committed to quality public education. Our parents believed strongly, not unlike many other parents, that education was the path to a good life, and quite honestly, to the goodness and potentially the fame of their children. Each child was given a fun name in addition to their given name, and those names embodied a goal. So to give you a sense of how large that goal was, although my sister has a beautiful voice, she probably is not going to sing at the Metropolitan Opera. And although I love playing the piano and other instruments, it is unlikely that I will perform at Carnegie Hall. Yet this is what they dreamed. It was great to have parents who could imagine such. My family moved to Charleston when I was an infant, as our father, a former teacher and principal who then went back to study to become an Episcopal minister, had been assigned to a parish there. My sister and I, tagging along during pastoral visits in the early years, I learned a great deal about people who worked hard, who could barely make it, and who had dreams for themselves and for their children. So many of the people in the parish were upper middle class, but many were quite poor. I remember and was moved by how committed they were, the disrespect they often tolerated, and their personal resolve. I can never forget it. Then and after, I understood that although I would share some of their experience, because I too was Black in the South, the opportunities that would be afforded me, because we were not wealthy, but would not be available to my friends in those households. That without help from others, the coupling of race and poverty would override desire, hope, and possibility. Back on my own street, there were reminders of the prominence of race over class. As white children, the only children on my block, were not allowed to play with Black children such as myself. The times were post-Brown and in the middle of the Civil Rights Movement, followed by the signing of the Civil Rights Act, with great national upheaval in between. Increasing the right to vote was important, and literacy was the way to ensure the vote. By the way, in the introduction, James referred to that typewriter I got. Times have changed in how people ask their children what to do. I want to be clear, I was told that I was going to type those envelopes. I wasn't asked. Adults met in our living room to learn to read in order to vote. While I did not know who Miles Horton was at the time, or that I would come to appreciate his writing, I knew the women who would take the lead in that movement: Septima Clark, Bernice Robinson, and our mother. Civil rights meetings continued after the signing of the Civil Rights Act to combat resistance to change. Racial epithets continued to be yelled out of windows, and the determination of people who were making everything happen persisted. In the mid-1960s, our church, with about 500 congregants, was bombed in response to rights organizing, our father's rights organizing. While these experiences are ever etched in my memory, they are paired with memories of enormous familial and extrafamilial love and support. And more academically, seeing the first Head Start program open in a small rural community. I share this background story largely because in it is embedded the possibilities and limitations of research. Constrained in its ability at times to capture the salience of learning histories in a single paper and pencil test, or through interviews and field work, even in the best ethnographic traditions, or with predictive analytics and administrative data. I share it as well to make public the complexities and tensions between apparent failures and hopelessness and between small victories and hope, in the midst of change and challenge. Embodied in the concept of equal educational opportunity, this year's theme and the promise of research. I have chosen the title, The Promise of Education, Research, and the Public Trust. It is intended to denote the present and future, but also the history of our past successes and failings, mapped against the possibilities as we enter into a state of beginnings for AERA and for ourselves. That is, to procure a path to equal educational opportunity. This year's theme is more than an intellectual nod to the enduring issues associated with unequal educational opportunity, or the dialectic of promise and achievement. It represents a sense of urgency to address these issues, not simply as business as usual, but business with purpose. It seeks criticality in pursuing answers to difficult questions with vigor, and moving from a place of knowing what the problems are to a place of rethinking how we understand the problems and where they reside, how we then choose to study them, and how we respond to them through practice and policy. Angela, James, and I hoped that our members would interpret the concept of equal educational opportunity as interdisciplinary and grounded in an array of research areas. For example, content teaching areas such as math, English, literacy, broad areas of inquiry, such as early childhood, secondary education, health. Specific problems facing children and families, such as homelessness, hunger, and juvenile incarceration. Larger social problems, such as poverty and vulnerability, and structural barriers, such as racial stratification, immigration, discrimination, access, and inequity. For the first time in my career, as I targeted the concept of access for my talk, public education itself is on trial. Its preservation bleak, and the hope that is attached to reforms increasingly precarious, if not totally unhinged. And equality of educational opportunity is at once historical, contemporary, political, complicated, naughty, some would suggest, and facile. And should anyone here assume that the historical problems of race and racism have all magically been reduced or eliminated? For example, that the mythical post-racial society of 2009 exists? The past year's politics should remind us all that the issues are different, the same, and worse than we remember. A country divided by ideology, solipsism, and hate in many instances, racial and gender bias that appear insurmountable, as well as other forms of difference, evidence-based that is being replaced with what Charles Payne calls evidence-free, education that appears at risk, fundamental rights around reproduction hanging in the balance, and gender identity and gender rights under attack. Our connections to global and international ideas and professional relationships met with fears about the other and others, the list goes on. Now, I am not naive about the realities of the world in which we live. I have been in a couple of airports when we were asked to take some cover because there was a threat. There are clear and present dangers and overwhelming reasons for concern about our safety and well-being as a field, as a nation, and as a global entity. With all of this in mind, we wrestle with the pressures and unyielding structures before us, raising the question, what does it mean to envision a field that contributes to our understanding of the world? What is our role as researchers, scholars, practitioners, policymakers, educators, and citizens? As parents, children, sisters, brothers, aunts, uncles, cousins, and friends? And making the world and the lives of those who live in it better? These are questions of enormous proportions in present-day perspective. When the very goals of research are in liminal space, the challenges to the goals of a democracy, civil liberties, and individual rights are being eclipsed. The ideals around learning and knowledge and justice are assailed. Practices and policies that promote expanding our view of the world and the potential greatness of our students and the institutions in which they study gives way to a narrowing of the definitions and the enactment of liberty and access. Where the realities of racism, poverty, and hardship are kept at bay from our everyday consciences and consciousness. As I contemplate all these events and problems that restrict our movement, our thinking, and that essentialize our work in the world, I contemplate, too, that equality of educational opportunity must exist in real time and with real students, families, and communities. The shrinkage of the problem is not organic. It requires that we not simply respond through pro forma research acts or even civil statements like the ones that Felice and I wrote over the course of the year, but through sound research that recognizes its potential power, and through researchers ourselves committed to ethical science, history, and the evolution of thought and action. Both are anchored in the generation of knowledge and the potential usefulness of that knowledge, particularly to the least among us, as an investment in change. This is a view of promise that is the focus of my talk, and that is at the center of my own imagination in fulfilling the public trust. So for the next maybe 30 minutes, I ask that we reflect on four sub-themes. First, a reflection on equal educational opportunity and the meaning of research. In 1916, when AERA was established, was a progressive period, was full of some possibilities, with the goal of making America a strong society. The air of reform was reflected in efforts to make big business more accountable, give people better working conditions, and improve the plight of new arrivals, mostly immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe. Keep that in mind for what I'm going to say later. There was a great deal of talk about making the world safe for democracy and movement toward giving women the vote, even as World War I approached. It was also a period of considerable contradiction. Seeking the vote, the suffrage movement in which a few black women had initially participated, including Ida B. Wells, became more adversarial than supportive, particularly on the issue of the black male vote. Within a matter of years, the National Origins Quota Act would be passed to restrict immigration from countries other than Northern and Western Europe. Remember the immigrants who were coming before from Southern and Eastern Europe. Rosenwald schools peppered African American communities throughout the South, about 500, and provided schooling through what is now considered the elementary grades, a practice that would continue well into the 1950s, shortly before the writing of the Coleman Report. People who completed the grades were permitted to teach if they received some additional college training. The next 50 years were brimming with possibility on the one hand and oppressive acts on the other. However, any review of research conducted prior to 1966 that focused on children and families from low-income, ethnically diverse families would yield relatively few studies. The commissioning of the Coleman Report ostensibly focused on student achievement, largely attested to the insignificance and invisibility of blacks in America. The Black Caucus of the Society for Research in Child Development has chronicled the slow and painful evolution of research on black children and families. With the exception of works by notable researchers of color, such as Clark and Clark, studies in the social sciences were flagrant in their focus on the deficits of minoritized children. For whom, then, did we and do we now see equal educational opportunity? To what are we referring when we talk about education research? Is it a series of experiments? Is it situated clearly in theory? Is it focused primarily on change or to understand and respond to the human condition? In what ways does it honor theory, study problems of local and global dimensions, and with what approaches and ways of thinking? Medicine may be a good place to think about these questions within the context of research goals and the intersections of promise and trust. For several personal reasons, I am a consumer and reader of medical research, which really irritates my doctor. Concerned about where it was done, by whom was it done, and with what implementation and success. That is, credibility and its potential effects short and long term. Countless medical journals, such as the New England Journal of Medicine, speak to the purpose and goals of medical research and the importance of trust, even though the public's rating of trust in medical providers is quite low. Recognizing that promise is constricted without public trust, and remembering its own violations of public trust, in cases such as the Tuskegee experiments, the field struggles to put in place rules for research and care. However, even with its life-saving and improving life mission, the questions of who gets to be served, for whom the Hippocratic Oath is designed, and how medicine will and can respond to the diversity of individuals have shaken the core of the field. As one colleague a well-known pediatric scholar commented to me, "This is not what we were trained to do. This is a new world." The increased focus on communication and engagement in both research and practice are but one example. Robert Wood Johnson Foundation's focus on the culture of medicine and the National Academy of Medicine's attention to the context of medical and healthcare and the social determinants are examples of persistent issues about the moral and ethical mission of the field, the changing demography of those who are served, and the willingness and resistances of the field to change. Although I am drawing upon medicine to make my point, I have generally found the use of the medical model as a prototype for education research to be problematic. However, despite my concern and because of my research on social determinants of health and education, I see that increasingly the two fields share affinities. For example, the dire straits that people whom we serve find themselves, the focus on issues of intersectionality and overlapping axes of oppression and their effects, and short-term and long-term impact of our practice. In many ways, both fields offer lifelines and legacies of hope. Education research offers a kind of promise, not necessarily of immediate returns to multiple audiences. So what is this promise? The use of the term promise conjures up a range of images around possibilities and allows the imagination to soar. How many of us have said, "I promise"? From childhood commitments and the honor code attached to it to marital pledges, the parameters of promise are often difficult to pin down. The most egregious or dishonest promise, some might suggest, is the political promise. Some promises take a long time to be realized, healthcare being among them and equal opportunity being at the forefront. A simple definition centers on the commitment to do something or not do something, an assurance that something will get done. "I promise to get to the dishes." Famous words of husbands and children alike, maybe just my husband and children, or the potential to make a contribution and the related responsibility. Promises may be oaths or legally enforceable contracts, and relevant for us as researchers, they may be social contracts. Not limited to intellectual disagreements dating back to Locke, Hobbes, and Rousseau. Among religions, Christianity and Islam agree on the importance of a promise, though they differ in references to promises, oaths, and vows. Philosophers, many of them at least, have argued for the purity of promises, while others argue that promises should be broken as needed to yield advantage. Promises are not intended to hurt, but they are often used as tools of manipulation. So how does a field or a set of conditions and findings move from offering promise to enacting promise? What interpretations of the importance of the promise are taken up and what counts as change? The recursive nature of these questions notwithstanding, I will draw on an historical note. According to sociologist Herbert Gans, President Lyndon Johnson, we're in his state, had hoped that the Coleman Report would advance his agenda for the war on poverty by focusing on the larger problem of inequality. Johnson, whose own family of origin had been thrust into deep poverty, understood that equal educational opportunity was not simply a Black, Latino, Asian, or Native American problem. It was also a white problem. The report held promise for his agenda. This point of history made a recent headline even more, perhaps disconcerting, if not curious, to me. Reporting on a conference at Johns Hopkins commemorating the Coleman Report, a journalist titled her article, "An Enduring Legacy, the Study That Changed the Conversation on Educational Equality." The title was based on an assumption there, in fact, had been a serious research or policy discussion about educational equality prior to the report. And if there had been, energetic, organic efforts ensued to eliminate past inequalities for all segments of the American population. I would have been more predisposed probably to accept that the report alone changed the landscape if the research community's attention to the inequities had predated the demands of the civil rights activists, many of whom were researchers, I might add, or had there been a larger number of studies that pointed to the deleterious effects of segregation or segregated schools. Given the significant role of the civil rights movement to the conduct of the Coleman study and the Monahan and Kerner Commission reports, the headlines suggesting that there was a shift rather than an awakening or an initiation of the conversation seemed overstated. One might even argue that the burden of years of segregation could not be replaced in the words or findings of this single report, despite its promise. So I will assume your fundamental knowledge of the report and the subsequent analyses, questions, and debates. Several of our colleagues have written about it, Gammer and Borman, among others. The report influenced the field broadly, particularly relevant to two fields of study that have been the focus of my work, and that is literacy research and the study of families and parents. So for a minute, I'm going to ask you to consider literacy's trajectory as a field in the early 1900s, and some of you may say this is revisionist history. Based on the 1910 census, 3% of whites reportedly were unable to read and write in any form, and 31% of blacks. The period between 1905 and the 1960s saw a modest increase in the literacy rates of African Americans, but comparably lower test scores on reading and writing as measured through the NAEP, with some of the highest scores by the late 1960s. By the 1960s, however, linguists had already begun to focus on the influence of verbal language, that is, non-standard dialects, such as Black or African American Vernacular English, AAVE, on children's reading development. In the late 1970s, the Ann Arbor decision and the court case Martin Luther King Jr. Elementary School Children et al. Versus the Ann Arbor School District recognized Black English as a language. The decision established that the Ann Arbor School District violated federal statutory law because it failed to take into account this home language in the provision of education. Linguist Geneva Smitherman, the primary witness, and the case itself became front page news. Some research attributed reading problems to deficit in the linguistic and literacy experiences of children. Others proposed a different theory in which AAVE was viewed as one dialect among many spoken dialects. Other leaders in the field, Goodman and Buck, argued that the reading failure of African American children was largely due to their teachers' problematic attitudes about their dialect. Ken Goodman's reading, A Psycholinguistic Guessing Game, and Ken and Yetta Goodman's work on whole language pushed back against long-standing frameworks based on skills approaches alone. What happened next was a reminder of the limitations of our points of entry as researchers into policy. That is, we may have findings, but how policymakers choose to interpret those findings can have unintended consequences. Interpreting Coleman's report on results as the problem being with families, policies were directed at investing directly in poor children's school experiences because we couldn't trust the parents, particularly their early learning, as a way to change the attitudes, beliefs, and practices of children, some would say, for the future. But they ignored the fact that children do not give up or give up on their parents simply because policymakers tell them to do so. Children's literacy achievement in school was seen as being inextricable from parents' capacity to engage them in school-like interactions and communications. The legitimacy of the literacies and abilities of low-income families of color was examined within the context of how closely or how distantly their practices resembled those of upper-middle-class white families. What had received little acknowledgement was that many of these practices were already occurring in the homes of many low-income families of color, though with some adaptations, as Durkin's work with low-income African-American families demonstrated. The dominant view that poor and undereducated parents are restricted in their ability to promote their children's literacy did not account for those children whose parents could not read, but who nonetheless achieved in school. Teachers in schools were tasked with greater responsibilities for children's well-being, while consuming subliminal messages that the family's knowledge mattered little. As literacy studies flourished in the 1980s, so did studies on families in fields such as sociology, anthropology, family studies, and developmental psychology. From the mid-1970s through the 1980s, literacy itself took on a much broader definition, embracing more than reading and writing, and extending to problem solving and ways of engaging and functioning in the world through culturally grounded and context-driven practices. Now, while some studies privileged linear and school-based literacies, others drew on the growing interdisciplinarity in the field, drawing from the fields listed earlier and others. Family literacy emerged as a research-based concept. In my own work, which happened after this time, that work focused on family cultures and intergenerational research with African-American and Latino families. The intersections of social practices, socio-political histories, and access combined for the formation of cultures within families. And like other studies, demonstrated that familial perspectives passed from one generation to another were revised contingent upon time, resources, and the ability to navigate around systemic barriers to engage an expanse of literacy acts and events. Sociologist Robert Hill has referred to these family practices as strengths. And without romanticizing the strategic uses of these strengths, he points to the ways that they are in constant interplay with social inequalities. A wave of studies emerged to change literacy and education writ large. Denny Taylor's insights into the patterns, diversity of patterns and processes of literacy learning within families. Shirley Bryce Heath's study of families in North Carolina and focus on the continuities and discontinuities of literacy practices at home and at school. William Teal and Elizabeth Soulsby's study on emergent literacy and its challenge to deficit perspectives. Danny Taylor and Catherine Dorsey Gaines' focus on Black families, oral and written text. Courtney Kasdan's text, Classroom Discourse, The Language of Teaching and Learning. Brian Street's research on autonomous and ideological models of literacy, as well as work by Sarah Michaels, James G., Concha Delgado-Gaitan, Richard Duran, Dorothy Strickland, Elsa Auerbach, and others. Literacy research is a good example of how a field moves from stasis to action and how it begins to unlock possibility and initiate the transformation of itself, though often with stubborn indignation. By the time I was in graduate school, the field had relied on cognitive frameworks primarily to address literacy had become smitten with Vygotsky's zone of proximal development. So it wasn't simply social or cognitive, it could actually be both. And it was beginning to embrace something different, not only the experimental and quasi-experimental side of empirical studies, but also the broader range of empiricism and ethnography, narrative, qualitative work, and discourse analysis. Moreover, just as Judith Green and David Bloom were writing about reading as a social process, the discourse in reading focused on new concepts, meaning-making, transactions with text, the composing process, metacognition, practitioner inquiry, and multicultural children's literature were being discussed in the same room with names such as those I mentioned earlier, along with Emick, Flower, Street, Shefflin, Lytle and Cochran-Smith, Sims Bishop, Harris, alongside other names such as Scott Paris, who was actually my dissertation chair, Anderson, Pearson, Brown, Harstey, Snow, and others. They were followed by the New Literacies Group with Luke, G, and others. The field began asking questions such as, what are the underlying sociocultural factors in understanding reading and writing, while maintaining its focus on the perennial questions of how children learn to read, the role of curriculum and instruction, strategic reading, and relevant print. On related fronts, adult literacy itself was reconsidering its own framework of adult learning, matching it to comparable frameworks in developmental psychology that focused on adult learning, Baltus and Warner-Shy in particular, creating opportunities to study the individual within multiple learning contexts and across the life course. School was seen as one of many contexts, and the reciprocity between home and school and between school and home, emanating from some of the attention to Bronfenbrenner's social ecological theories, became a source of information used both wisely and differentially in supporting students' learning. The field was afire with new synergies that could further enhance researchers' ability to uncover and address the needs of children. What might have occurred if there had been less willingness to open the field as it moved from business as usual to business with purpose and action? The story of literacy's evolution or the continuing growth in family research is not ideal. But the theoretical debates that defined and divided the field in the 1960s were tempered, but the pragmatics of the field's rethinking its purpose appropriately continues. We see a field that continues to grapple with change. Education research that fails to engage in this self-reflection or close examination is far from fulfilling its purpose, nor is its understanding of the end goals particularly clear. Like other fields, literacy research as a proxy for equality has a new and cutting-edge group of researchers who take up issues that are centered in both theory and change, that aim to enact practices within the realities of how children, adults, and families learn, reframing of pedagogical perspectives to take us from skills to cultural responsiveness, sustenance, funds, and assets, from Ladson, Billings, and Gonzalez and Moll to Paris, that's in Django, Rousseau, Park, and others. It extends to ideas regarding teaching and engagement, from digital learning to restorative pedagogy, and includes names from Hull to Fisher, Hoxson, Zacher, Vasudevan, Kirkland, and Storniola. It embraces not only schools, but also communities and coalitions, such as the work of Jones and of Campano and Guiso and their current and former students. It challenges us through literacy and power, for instance, the work of Jenks, and long-held ideas, and teases apart the reading of history and the reading of new text from Lee Gutierrez, Violet Harris, Dyson, Lytle, and Sisa, to Thomas, Dutrow, Soto Manning, Kinlaw, Haddox. It looks to different literatures to expand our understanding of students' needs and context, from studies on families to studies on students' individual and collective identities, boys of color, immigrants, girls of color, assessment, digital learning, and gender. It pushes us to consider our local context, but also to focus on transnational context. There are few fields where practitioners seek more support in promoting equal educational opportunities, or where parents rely more openly on practice and research to help them and their children realize their promise. The frameworks are neither perfect nor necessarily complete. The understandings across disciplines are still relatively muddled, and the girth of ideas is still being determined. However, the reconceptualizations of the possible are evident. Like culture, the field is fluid. And like AERA, it is in the beginning of multiple formulations and reformulations of ideas, concepts, and methodologies. The next step in realizing promise is to map the landscape, to imagine and enact possibility. Maxine Green, in her presidential address, wrote, without some explanation of America, without a sense of a better order of things. We would not be moved to break through the limits or to repair the insufficiencies we see. But we are educators, and education has to do with new beginnings and reach toward what is not yet. Whatever our locations, whatever our vantage points, we cannot help but lean into the future. Not uncommon to her writing is the sense of the possible, but also a fervent admission of the constraints to the possible. Not to be discouraged, but to be wary and clear-headed about next steps, both of the abstract and the concrete. So it's here that I begin with what I consider concrete areas of inquiry that lie in the landscape ahead. The social ecologies in which we live and in which we are situated require that we consider the social location, racial realities, gender and sexuality oppressions, and persistent disparities in our midst. Whether by force or quiet resolve, we will be faced with making public where we stand and what stance we will take to engage in the critical and rigorous inquiry that our field demands, the potential of children, families, and communities merit, and the public deserves. What is the call, and how do we answer it? The fundamental questions facing the field have not changed dramatically. How children learn and are motivated to learn, what they learn, how they are engaged, and how learning is facilitated through teaching and curriculum are at the core of our work. To think about what constitutes a curriculum and the opportunities afforded to students to interrogate their own assumptions and to engage in what Bowler and Zimbalist describe as pedagogies of discomfort acknowledges the emotional labor and the cognitive, emotional, and social dispositions that teaching inhabits. We are living in a time when even the young choose to restrict their own freedoms and those of others. Not necessarily because of what they know, but mostly because of what they do not know. In a time when intolerance is tolerated, when parochialism outweighs discovery, and when anger overrides uncommon common sense, one cannot help but reflect on the Charleston episodes and ask, sorry, I'm from Charleston, whether the perpetrator's schooling by intent or neglect informed, challenged, or failed him, and if yes, how? If racism is taught, are we able to unteach it? There is an urgency to our commitments to elevating basic areas of research, scholarship, and thought as individual power and individual rights are contradicted and contested in the public sphere. When the public trust is thwarted by under-theorized and poorly developed analysis of both the problem and the possibility. In the landscape ahead, the problems of equity, access, and equality persist as challenges to eliminate. Peering into the new social discourses, still too little work focuses on changing rural schools and needs, and urban schools are increasingly being dismembered. The future of education to which the public has free access is being tendered like a fine day at the market might be imagined, with little apparent regard for the future of all children. It is the public who must save education, but that support is at risk. And the heat for public schools is the heat for communities, locales, and states in which schools sit and in which children and families hang their hopes for the future. I am interested in urging a more rigorous academic discourse and research agenda, as well as a responsive public discussion and agenda, in which the issues of the academy, of schools, and of communities and neighborhoods intersect, or even better, unite as one. Just as poverty and race continue to serve as barriers, so does a multitude of social determinants that reproduce intergenerational and social exclusion. All undermine the solvency of strong communities and influence public perception of who counts and what is possible for those who have the fewest financial and institutional resources. In addition, without education and schooling, issues of gender and sexuality have moved to the center of discussions of equality, access, and justice, long overdue. Gender identities are intrinsic to the experiences and identities of learners across the life course, including their representations of self, social roles, and contexts in which gendered roles as boys, girls, women, men, mothers, fathers, children, workers, or as gay, lesbian, transgender, cisgender, and others are assumed and enacted. Similar to a focus on the social markers of race, culture, and class, a focus on gender and sexuality is important to understanding how learners approach, resist, or embrace learning in school and other educational settings. The resistance to the naming of the trans, lesbian, gay, and other gendered identity is an issue about which scholars and researchers can bring their enormous knowledge to act, and we could actually begin here in San Antonio. Works by Patricia Hill Collins, Kimberly Crenshaw, Martha Nussbaum, and Judith Butler, that I have all of those names in the same space is kind of interesting, quite different in their theoretical stances, all provide us with a critical perspective on the ways race, class, gendering, and performance come to define and objectify the identities of women and others. Moreover, the provocative report on the treatment of girls of color, comparable reports on boys of color, and the accompanying statistics from Dan Lozen and the Civil Rights Project and Russ Skiba on discipline sound a clear alarm for the well-being of these and other children. All is not lost, however, as Sean Harper and his colleagues and Tyrone Howard demonstrate the potential of young men of color to succeed. A compelling issue in moving forward is our reconceptualizations of who matters and how. Our responsibilities as researchers and educators to eliminate either concepts or practices that suggest that children or their families are disposable. My own research and my read of different literatures have informed me that this sometimes invisible group of children is large. The homeless, children exposed to trauma, children challenged with physical and mental health problems, children of incarcerated parents, and incarcerated youth. America's greatest fears are often centered on whether children will repeat the choices and crimes of their parents, rather than whether and how we provide the best conditions for them to learn and thrive. In all of this, the question posed by officials, what do children's lives reveal about their parents, is not sufficient to examine the complex set of relationships that exist between these children and families across different generations and across communities. Whose lives matter and who matters in our school are among the most penetrating questions that research might inform. Big questions are sitting within the public square, waiting for the uptake. Some need refinement. For example, studies of families and parents, immigrant parents, parents of children with special needs, incarcerated parents, and early child development and education. Other questions abound. For example, learning and teaching literacy, science, and other content areas. New framings of identity in which categorical divisions, male, female, black, white, Latino, are increasingly inadequate in naming access, power, and participation in schooling and society, to name a few. Other questions are just on the periphery, pedagogy, and practice that address diversity, not limited to race, class, and gender, but examining other questions such as religion, disability, immigrant transitions, health disparities, and the implications for education, as well as neighborhood effects. These areas of inquiry are by no means exhaustive of the range of emerging and long-standing conceptual issues. In the good high school, Sarah Launch Lightfoot, who was, by the way, outstanding yesterday, argued that rather than focusing on the weaknesses and the pathology of education and schooling, that we search for what is strong and resilient, that we seek places of optimism, not simplistic hopes, but spaces to draw upon interdisciplinary and cross-domain knowledge. Find the synergy and transform education. These goals seem fundamental to embracing the responsibility of research to the public trust. So how then do we fulfill our promise and embrace the public trust? There is a special definition of public trust that relates to the origins of democratic government and the idea that within the public lies the true power and future of a society. Several words and concepts are used interchangeably and often with the concept of public trust. Social ethics and professional ethics are subparts, and then there's feminist ethics or global ethics, feminist justice ethics, applied ethics, it goes on. The public trust doctrine itself has a special meaning based on ancient laws that held the sea, the shores, things of the sea, the air, and running water to be common for everyone. This idea of public trust draws on basic tenets of ownership and the public, that all children have access to the public domains that promote fundamental needs, for example, water. Within recent times, even this idea of having water has been challenged and violated in multiple ways. As the children of Flint, by no fault of their own, have experienced and will experience. Other relevant concepts help us create an understanding for public trust, such as community trust or public express trust. 100 years after the creation of our beloved association, it is appropriate for us to revisit our mission and to ask, what does it mean to consider the purposes of our research? What are the pathways to realizing its promise? And how do we respond to the public trust? A complementary question is, how do we want to imagine ourselves and build the field and a legacy? That decision is up to us. We have begun to address some of these issues through multiple activities in AERA, reach into the local engagement and national policy formulations, alliances with other research organizations, commitments to the public good, among others. However, it will be our everyday teaching, scholarship, research, and yes, public personas that the educational community, children, families, and the public will look for answers. I think we are up to the task. It is not uncommon or unusual for us to weigh what is lost against what is gained when entering new situations, since each new situation brings change and uncertainty. The uncertainty of change becomes more pronounced when we are entering a situation in which our own backgrounds and vulnerabilities may be disclosed and negotiations may be needed. In thinking about how we go about revisioning our work and honoring AERA's mission, I urge us all to consider the short and longer term agenda and framework, not only in determining salient issues of inquiry, but also in determining the best pathways to pursuing the work, making it public and transparent, and ensuring the likelihood that it will make a difference, reminiscent and explicative of this year's meeting theme and themes of the past. By making a difference, I am thinking about theory building and knowledge generation that are propelled and validated by academic institutions, but that also extend themselves by design into the world and to both individuals and groups who are most in need, particularly those who continue to reside in the margins of quality schooling and society, equal access, and appropriate representation in our work. In short, I am referring to contexts and issues that are at the core of the elusive reality of educational equity and the barriers to children achieving excellence in schools. I'm also referring to their families having the wherewithal to support their path to excellence while maintaining a sense of the cultural and social domains of home and community. Our reliance on trust is located in our relationships with other researchers and with our students. It relies on our ability to build trust with those whom we study and to be earnest in seeking and honoring that trust. How we choose to collect and interpret data, that is, whether we respond to the obvious patterns in our data because those patterns are familiar to us, or whether we grapple with findings that push against our professional and personal wisdom. These issues of public trust, and emotional trust, I might add, are fundamental to whether the public will allow us to enter and what it expects from policies. Now, much of what I have discussed emanates from what has been learned from research on and legislation from Mendez versus Westminster, Brown v. Board, Civil Rights Act, and Law v. Nichols, among other pieces of legislation, reinforcing the critical role of policy to ensure learning and freedoms. However, within our commitments as researchers lies the promise of children to be realized and hope for a political will to promote the public good. We are not alone in this venture or adventure. With other fields such as medicine and law and throughout the disciplines, these questions are embodied in short and longer term missions. Centered in this view is a presumption of trust, a reciprocal relationship between researchers and the public built upon trust. Without the public, we do not have research. And without sound research that can prompt responsive policies, the options around access and equality of opportunity may be limited. However, in the absence of society that takes seriously the principles of a democracy and civil rights, neither research nor practice nor advocacy will matter. It is difficult to imagine, especially for some of my younger colleagues, given the turmoil and tumultuous nature of current events in our country, but we are at one of the most critical moments of our professional work. To ensure that public access to education is not decimated on the one hand or marred on the other, that is to determine as an association at this beginning of our second century what we mean by the public good and how we will promote it. Some argue quite appropriately that research is limited in its ability to affect change. I agree that research in its own right has enormous limitations to affect change. Without policies that can translate the possibilities of research into opportunities. Some of the best research is still hidden in the back of some policymakers' memoranda drawer. However, even when research does not immediately result in sweeping transformations, its purposes are not reduced. Like so many great ideas whose time must come, some of the best ideas become clear and acceptable over time. Once when I was in graduate school, Yuri Bronfenbrenner talked about how many times his article was rejected. I think it was 10. On the 10th time, it was accepted by American psychologists. Our own history of educational change reminds us of these purposes, and our own personal histories often locate our determination, dreams, and hopes. I will always treasure having been president of AERA, appreciative to former presidents, many of whom are sitting on this front row, and of future presidents. I hope you will embrace the humanities and humanness, and that you will continue to work for change as we continue in the struggle. I will both relish and look forward to opportunities to work with you for change. And I want to thank you for what I consider a glorious year. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. And now it is time for me to pass the gavel. So I'm going to ask Deborah Ball to come up. And here you come. Let's give applause to Deborah.
Vivian, on behalf of all of us in the room, thank you so much for your talk, for your leadership, for your grace, and for the many ways you help us think about how we're human in the ways that we conduct our work. Thank you for everything you've done. And I'm proud and honored to take the gavel from Vivian Gadson and to serve this community on following so many great leaders who are sitting right here. I can see you, and thank you for all the help you've already provided me. And I look forward to being part of the chain of people who together are trying to fulfill our mission as education researchers. Next year's meeting will be held in New York City from the 13th to 17th of April. On behalf of my program co-chairs, Carla O'Connor and Suzanne Wilson, we're pleased to let you know the theme will be the dreams, possibilities, and necessity of public education. Hope to see you next year there, and thank you so much.